eu reconheci ele da. Minha fome com vontade de comer, literalmente.
Aí ela fala. todos os pacientes. E aí eles estão no processo de trials, blá blá blá. Que aí, efetivamente era o sistema imunológico atacando o próprio organismo.
Não, não é só era a
É. Tem uma coisa engraçada aqui, ó. O cérebro fica dentro de uma membrana e, como é que se diz? Ele é autoimune, ou seja, se aquela membrana quebrar, o sistema imunológico ataca o cérebro. É separado, é um sistema separado, para assim dizer. Então, por isso que o meningite é tão perigoso, porque o sistema imunológico meio que ataca o cérebro junto com todo o resto.
Depois cancelli.
Thank you.
Okay, welcome everyone to the last day of SBMM. It's good to see that many of you are here, despite the social event. It's my pleasure to introduce our invited speaker this morning, Leo Freitas. He is a local. He was born here in Salvador, but he studied with some of the people in the audience, Adolfo and Augusto, in Bahia and Pernambuco. And then moved to the UK, first to York, to work with Jim Woodcock on ZEs and proof systems for Z, and then to Newcastle to work on medical devices. So I think ZEs work was mostly concerning avionics system, and now he's working on medical devices at Newcastle. So without further ado, I would like to welcome Leo Freitas.
So yeah, it's great to be here. After my first paper was in Nagoya in 2001, and then it's given however many years later. It's great. So the idea of the talk is to give you an impression of a few social technical experiments that I underwent from the last 5 years or so, and you know, how formal methods can help. And I guess I was surprised by a number of things. I'll try to share those stories here with you. I'll try to keep more about the stories, and I can talk more about the technical detail if you have interests. But I guess the take-home message is there is no railroad. It was really surprising for a number of reasons that were not entirely intuitive. This work is in collaboration with a number of people. You can list them all there, but these are the main people. Michael Drinan in the NHS, who was the device lead for one of the devices I worked on. Patrick Degener is the engineering lead for the brain pacemaker device. And Bill Scott is the engineering lead from the organ preservation machine in the NHS blood and transport. These people are great to work, so they are physicists, electronic engineer, and biomedical person. So they're very heavy, very different backgrounds. So why do this? So devices are usually produced by companies that are small, and they are pressed for budget, and there isn't a software engineer in the loop. Mostly that medics and physicists or electronic engineers come along rushing through best effort type thing to fit the standardization process. The field is in the UK, and well, in Europe at least, you have CE marking, which is like certification, and you get certificate for software within it. It's tricky. They don't recognize, as we would, certificate in software, and that was our first surprise. They do have classifications, class A, class B, class C, software, but technically they still have talks about not having to have a hardware fallback. So if a bubble comes, the hardware will lock it regardless of any control from the software. But in practice, that's not quite like that how it works. So the standards are also slight. They provide guidelines. They don't give you a roadmap. They're not as precise. And yeah, the engineers. And they try to have identified risks and control measures for each risk, and then that's enough. It doesn't, so it's almost like testing to a certain extent for the identified risks. And you have ad hoc software engineering, no language subsets, again, best effort or previous experience from the electronic engineering backgrounds. So the idea was, how can we transfer the skills from formal methods to this area? Because to me, it felt like, well, what's the difference between a medical device, say a dialyzer, and an ABS system? Well, it's an embedded box, closed, control, executing and manipulating it. So it should be all right to we have something to say for this field. And the idea is that we improved the correctness or the dependability of these systems before clinical trials, because trials are very expensive and very lengthy. And you know, it's hospital time and patients involved and so on. So we really wanted to try and influence the early if you could, but then you also have to participate during the trials, because in the end that's what we need the market. And the idea is to, as I said, share with you some of the social technical experiences within this. So the way it works, at least in my experience with this, is they have a kind of pre-market review process where they go like, right, is this certifiable? And if it is, they sell their IP. Usually small companies doing it. Unless you're Philips Medical, and then you go from inception to design through commercialization. So basically, you imagine a small group that develop an idea, make it a patented, create the IP, then they want to sell it. To sell it on, you need to demonstrate to whoever is buying that it can really certify this. And you have to convince a notified body. In the UK, you have BSI and a number of other bodies, and these are the people who give you the certificate. They do things like expose the device to temperature, smash it with a hammer, and physical things like that, the electrical tests, fire tests, and so on, and software. Despite the fact that the software part is a bit not as strict as I would have liked. And there is another problem, which is the documentation is really mind-boggling. It's enormous. You have, I don't know, 20 is another estimate. It's about 40, however you look at it. And it's different in different countries. In the UK, it's different from the US. It's different from Japan. And that means you get a lot of burden from it. And understanding the super letters is really tricky. Which ones affect you, depending on where your software, in our case, touches the device. But nominally, there's only one for software, and that is the so-called 6.3.4, but it doesn't talk about criticality or defense mechanisms. The way it works is that you want to describe measures taken to ensure risks are as low as possible, and these include careful identification. By careful, they mean whatever these ISO standards tell you to do, of hazards, and demonstrating this through field testing, either in clinical trials or in clinical investigations. And risks associated with this are mitigated, and this is best effort. So to demonstrate that you mitigated, so the dialyzer, for instance, was working for 2,000 hours on sick babies. And that's kind of a demonstrator. And you have to demonstrate that you have created the barrier between the hazard and its consequence. So I thought to mention something here that is a personal experience with this. The way I came to start working on this was because there was a talk in Newcastle by a professor in the UK, and he was talking about human pups, the things that you put, education, food, whatever. So it's one of the low-brow trivial software, medical devices, but pervasively used. He was talking about in the US at one point, all intrusion pumps were recalled. All of them. It caused millions in loss and so on. And he was talking about the errors that these devices caused and the variations of why some of them had to do interfaces like the dot V, the zero, and then people giving order of magnitude errors at input time, or hidden assumptions about the interface. He was mostly talking about interface, that's fine. This was back in 2013. A week later, I left the talk, said, oh, that's interesting. A week later, I found myself in that position. My daughter was born prematurely, and I saw her using the same pump that he was talking about. I was like, oh, God. Shit. What am I going to do? And more, worse than that, the device failed. And I was like, you know, it was a life or death situation, because the amount of food she was taking was dependent on a number of conditions. Surgery, whatever. The point was, the device was giving her half the amount that it was supposed to, and that's because they forgot to calculate the flyback to kilos. But to me, the point is, if you are using the device at 2 kilos, and then shift change, a nurse is there, and then the new nurse forgets to put 2 times, the device, if you attach the same patient to, you say, look, you're giving half the dose, is that all right? Is that right? So I mean, there, it's about the state of the device that you'd like to keep for the same patient, for instance. After that, I was like, nah, I need to do something about this. And that was the motivation. I'm happy to tell you that she's fine. So that was a kind of wake-up call, and I said, all right, okay, what can I do? So I thought to bring the experience that I had before working in the critical industry for aerospace and avionics mostly, but not so much the theory, but the application. My experience, I guess, and I think Augusto, he was the first one to mention this to Jim at one point. He said, you know, this is good with systems and large scale things. So I'm good at, I guess, identifying good theory to put to practice. So the idea was to identify and explore different languages and tools. And I am tool agnostic, despite the fact that I've been brought up in the CSPZ world. I was basically trying to find the right tool for the task at hand, but most importantly, it had to be something that the designers were happy to use. There's no point simply bringing something that is interesting or technically good, but then unusable for the engineers. And I was focusing on 2 things. One was the analysis of the design, and so mostly these are finite state machines and properties that they should satisfy, or code level verification, usually in C or C++, or a combination of both. And I was, the first shock in the process was, I said, okay, I'll demonstrate this, I'll give the evidence, provide the papers, give talks about it, and so on. And the so what question from people in the audience were things like, well, but the regulation doesn't notice this, so it's wasted effort. Namely, if we don't care, as a problem. So it took a few cycles, and only when I found actual errors that they missed, that the trials missed, that they started to listen. And that was part of the exercise, I guess. So I then learned, I had to see how is it that what I'm going to do will be within the regulatory process. And I had to have a direct input to their hazard analysis, their hazard risk, because that's their language. If you don't talk in that language, they just don't listen to you. Even when you find an error, they try to, oh well, but that won't matter because in legal justification. But if you talk in regulatory terms, then this. So we wanted to see if that would be viable. How do we do that? The choices of languages they do depended on how open the engineers were, and how much time they had to give you to explain things, how well documented things were. And when I got involved, or when formal methods experts get involved. And the idea here is, I realized very quickly, this was a social technical expert. It was not, it's not just a matter of, oh, I know how to do proof, I know how to do modeling, just go there, do it, and go home. It was a matter of convincing them, teaching them, understanding their problems in the domain, how to really do interdisciplinary exchange, if you like. So on the design, I used a number of tools, and I started with FDR and CSP, in a tool called Verum, because it was used with Philips Medical, and there was a massive project on this, and that failed in a way because I entered the project late. So Verum requires things to be very compartmentalized and component based. And in their case, they have a kind of a big over, you know, bird's eye view. So three syringes, and then they didn't have a model of one syringe replicated three times. They had three models of syringes that were slightly different from each other. So that didn't work. I collaborated with people who worked in the medical device domain for interfaces, and they suggested to me mild model action logic, and its underlying model checker in the SMB, and we did risk property analysis through it. And I also used PDM and Isabel for symbolic simulation and proof of specific properties of the finite state machine. Again, symbolic simulation is useful because you can play with the device without needing to be in either with an implementation in your hand or in the theater. There's a story that Donald mentioned at the debugging session they did on the hospital bed. It was very fun. We'll come to that in a minute. So on the code level, the difficulty there was some of the code was in C, and then you can choose C verification tools. Some of the code was in C++, some of the code was a mixture between the two. And when it's mixed, how do you do it? You have to kind of, you can't tell the look, you should separate. Look, you don't really need this. That's not the right way around. So we found out a way to use things like Daphne because it's simpler and easier, not so much detail. To discover a specification that would fit a problem within understood, then used ECV, which is the HSC verifier. It's a tool used in the aerospace military domain. It is a certified tool in that domain, so it's a tool that can be used for their designs. And most importantly, it does tackle C and C++ mixed together. It's the only tool that we find that did this. But also, it has NISR compliance, which is the subset of C for the automotive industry, but it also provides you what it's a resolution prover, but the proofs it gives, it gives an audit trail, so like a proof object explaining all the steps along the way, and that is used in the certification of military software as evidence. So in a way, I thought, well, this would be, they're gonna jump at this, so yeah, this is good. But it's there if it's necessary as a mitigation measure. The process is roughly like this, where you get a module or a system or a subsystem. I try to find what kind of specification I have to do. This wasn't the case of the dialyzer, but if it's the case, I kind of annotate the code in C, verify if it passes, I iterate, which is the usual loop. The difference here in using PDM was to abstract away from the details if necessary, because if you're trying to discover a specification in the fitness of C, it can be sometimes, you know, you're chasing red herrings. They're not really important, but they are quite crucial to the process. So ECV, just, you know, it's, if you've seen this kind of verifier, you get C code with annotations like these. Frame clauses, invariants, and so on. Okay, so that's the context.
Why is it called the Azure C verifier? Do I end up walking on the C?
No. It's by a guy called Toka, and his company is called Azure Technologies, and that's just the name of the company. But yeah, he likes Azure, the drawer, the actor drawer. I happen to like him as well, the very good. So the social technical experiments, and that's what I'm going to try and talk to you about. So the first one was an infant dialyzer for the NHS. The design span was about this long, about 10 years in the development from inception to commercialization. I got involved in 2014, and that was my first device. I'll talk more about these details in a moment. The second one is a brain pacemaker. Its primary function is to prevent epilepsy, but it has other practical applications like Parkinson's, Alzheimer, and other brain ailments. And this is an EPSRC project in Newcastle with Imperial College. And the third one is organ preservation machine, and it started this year, but actually I've been involved from the very beginning. The interesting thing here is, this is late participation, medium participation, midpoint participation, and early participation, and interesting differences in the process. So I was very lucky. Newcastle is great for this because I was told it's one of the few places in the UK that you can go from inception of the problem, the guy in the hospital figuring out the problem and is a solution through developing up the machine, through certification and commercialization, all in one place. For the research hospitals, engineers to do it, the scientists to do it, and so on. So that's great. The medical school is just across the road. So what's the device? It's an infant hemodialyzer for premature babies. And that was a kind of a funny thing because I had to go a number of times to the same ward in the ward, and I was like, oh, come on, that's kind of fateful. But anyway, so it's a prototype. It was made by the news in the UK, the Daily Mail, said things like, he's the kid in MacGyver, because he put together some pumps and some wires, and then he was manually doing the actual dialysis, and that, he said, no, that's too crude. Let's make a machine out of it. The key thing to understand about baby dialysis is that a normal dialysis machine is a two-channel system. You one syringe here, take the blood out, filter it, and put the bullet back to the double channel. The circuit volume alone is more than the baby's full blood, so you can't do that. And the speed of dialysis needs to be much faster. So what they came up with is a design where it's a single channel, the blood enters here, this valve opens, that's closed, gets into this syringe, that valve closes, that one opens, it goes through a filter, fills in this syringe, then goes back to the filter, that's heparin to avoid clotting. And then that closes, that opens, and goes back to the baby, and repeat. Okay? That's the dialysis cycle. So that's the real machine. It's about this big. It works in the hospital in Newcastle. It's the only one of its kind in the world. It was developed by this IMD people, Microdrillion. And it's IMD is a NICE center, so NICE is the regulator within the NHS for medical devices. So they are the ones that say, oh, that's a good device, you can use it in the hospital. So as well as being the gatekeepers for devices, they develop devices themselves. So in that sense, they are a great team to collaborate with because they are at the forefront of the problem, but at the same time, they are R&D people as well, and very experienced engineers. So they had this risk analysis in CE market, required prior to handover to a company in 2017. And we worked on the final state machine, controlling the cycle of dialysis and on the C code. So the final state machine looks like that. They put this as a CSV file, but an Excel spreadsheet of about 155 states and about 50 events that could control. So it is, the point being, it's a complicated set of transitions and options and possibilities, and the question is there something wrong in one of them under some circumstances? The answer, insofar as the trials are concerned, is no, everything's okay. We go find one. And in their mind, everything was okay. In France, they did a very carefully engineered design. So, I worked first at the code and found some issues there, but the issues in the code were hard to bring up to what risk that piece of code problem would be associated with. And therefore, it was like, well, man, it's not that very interesting. And then we changed tactics, and instead we went to the actual Word document. This is a kind of a Word document with a spreadsheet of hazards, numbers, like a requirements document. And then you know, it's a, you have a, the actual physical risk identified and who is responsible to deal with it, the controller software, the mechanical device, and in all the analysis states, the prep valve is closed because you don't want to aspire, what is it called, the kind of dialysis fluid into the solution. So basically what we did was to get these terms in English and transform them into technology formally or some other forms of property descriptions mathematically and check that against a CSV or MAU view of this table, and then you can auto check the design. More importantly, if they change the design, and they had to during the trials, you can then press the button and check it all again, and then say, ah, this failed, and wow, how bright it is. So then they started to see the value of this. Because, heard about the form and check the property using USMD, but possible and PDS when USMD wasn't capable. PDS is the preferred theory tool for Michael, who did some of the work, my colleague Mike Harrison, who did some of the work on this. So what were the questions of interest? There are things like, you have alarm fatigue in these wards, and I know this firsthand, you know, you're there in the ward, and then you hear, and I was like, oh my god, something's wrong there, life is fine. They just get used to the alarm. And either, so you can't over alarm, but you can't under alarm either, and getting the right kind of alarm is not easy, it's really complicated. And you had invariants between attributes, like if you are in a dialyzing state, you cannot do certain things. If you are in an error state, you cannot go to an error state. You can only have certain messages after certain parts of the cycle are in place. So we worked on this, and through model checking of the hazard, model checking each one of the hazards in the hazard profile as a property against some mathematical model of the fire state machine. This ended up being recognized by the certification process people. They were like, ah, this is cool. You can now change the design, press a button, and then, it gave them a kind of, that's a nice way to do it. That was pleasing. It was a yes moment. And in the code case, we managed to make the code user compliant up to the required level, so the highest level of user compliance. The code's about 5,000 lines of code, and we could, parts of the code, particularly the one that loaded the finite state machine, could be automatically generated from the formal model that we had. We wrote this model that did this as well. Another lesson from this world is publishing this kind of stuff is very difficult, because some of this stuff is not terribly complicated insofar as formal methods is concerned. So the formal methods targets I went to, I said, well, so what? This is not interesting. The medical journals were like, what's model checking? And then it became a conundrum to get the right level of detail on each side. We managed eventually to get a paper that's now submitted in SCP. I was in a meeting with the MHRA, and their headquarters are now in Nicaragua, the same thing with the foreign office.
The same vision as this.
I think so. And something like this happened in the middle of the mission, and people say, no, they're listening, let's switch it off. So the kinds of properties that we checked, there are things like states are inaccessible in certain dangerous circumstances. So it's not possible to dialyze if there is heparin in the closed circuit. When the machine is error-free, it generates a correct dialysis sequence, so a kind of positive test. And it always includes a wash and dialysis stage. I'll explain this in a minute. And when an error occurs, you go to the appropriate error state, namely you can't recover from error without either intervention or alarming. So you can't simply ignore errors. Okay. One of the things that Harati will be the guy that talked about Ethereum bugs. He showed the paper he has is very nice. He shows a number of calculators and devices that eat up errors. So if you have division by zero, so say 5 divided by 0 plus 3, it gives you 3 as an answer in some calculators. It gives you error in some calculators. So it absorbs the error. And it's almost like undefined. You know, is it contagious or is it strict? But anyway, so, how certain states were reached. The cycles in the analysis, there are 4 cycles. One is start, so basically put the syringe in the right positions, the pumps in the right positions. Then you have reset, start, switch it on. Reset puts the various pieces of hardware in the right position. Wash sterilizes the circuit for a number of minutes, and then dial out, which is the actual functionality. The key or most important error we found in the design was at some points, right after washing and starting of dialysis, that valve there would aspire this. So basically, that valve was open when it shouldn't be. That's it. And if that was the case, you would aspire the dirty water, because this is the dialysis to make the dialysis in the filter by osmosis, and this is the dirty water used. Well, dirty now, but the water used. One for a buck wasn't there. Finding that is part of the exercise too. So, the buffer bug is in this piece of code. This is at the heart of everything the dialyzer does. Every single decision that it's taken is taken based on what happened in this computation, even to one output. Every event for what you do next in the state machine is decided by this. At first, it looks like simple. You have some masking and another masking and some deltas between that masking, and then you give it up. I asked them, what does it do? And I was told, well, you have different clocks, and basically what happens is you get different reads at different times, and they overlap. You need to make the decision between the data that you've got. So I said, okay, but what do you want this to do? I said, well, calculate that delta. What is it exactly? And they couldn't quite explain it in the way that I needed to. Well, I said, what's the precondition? What do you want to establish? What's the commitment that you want? And so on. And then I said, okay, fine, I'll start. NISRA checks on this fail immediately because you can't do bit vector arithmetic with unsigned signed integers because in some C compiler that's not right. So that's the first one. There was another one there in the case that this may be negative, and then indeed you are exactly in that situation. And in fairness, the designers were using so-called Windows Lean and Mean, so they were using Visual Studio Compiler. And in Visual Studio Windows, bit vector arithmetic for negative numbers works in a particular way, and they were taking advantage of that, and that's not true of every compiler that you use. And therefore, when they sell this to the whoever buys it, it needs to rebuild the whole thing. That's a dependence that nobody knows. Not even the design, you have no way to. and so I, this kind of bit vector as well as a test at the same time in Israel is not happy with. But I tried to say, okay, tell me first what is this? He said, oh, well, I only care about the 3 bits, the comic help. So 3 bits, right, so, okay. So it's a number that has that many bits, I think, 255, 0 to 255, 7 bits. And it must be a positive number. I said, oh, if it's a positive number, why not put unsigned int everywhere? So put unsigned int. And Israel is very fiddly, so we have to say this constant is unsigned as well, otherwise the Israel check doesn't say yes. So the point there being, some of this is very fiddly, nitty gritty. and the tool ECV gives you very interesting hints. Because it's a resolution prover, it can tell you, try this. If you try that precondition, you establish a postcondition. in some cases, right? If it succeeds, if it terminates, it gives you a hint, and that's very useful. But sometimes the hints are like this, and that's not the precondition of interest. And I had, what I did here was scratch my head and think, try to simplify this using Hentrus. And then I realized, actually, the SEO4 people in Isabel have done that kind of thing before, loaded Isabel up with the libraries for Bitvector, Word Arithmetic, and then turned this into a simpler format. And I actually got to something more like that, but still not happy. They told me, actually, this number is meant to be a 13-bit number because this is the packet size of the machine. So it's 13 bits. That's helpful. Okay, so the output is, it's a 13-bit number. So 0 to 8,180, whatever. And eventually, I got to this specification, and I showed this to them. They said, yes, that's exactly what it does. I said, great, okay, you tell me this in the first bit. So if you curve here, basically, is apply this mask to these inputs. So this is just that is the same as this expression, and that's the same as this expression. Their delta must be from -4 to 3. In other words, they disagree by 3 one side, by 3 on the other side, or they don't disagree at all. And when you think about it in those terms, it makes perfect sense. So if you have two inputs that are competing to define what's going to happen, they are taking their delta in this way, and that's the maximum distance that they can have because, well, that's the mask, 3 bits. So this is a very sensible specification, to my point, and with it, the fruits go through and the code is correct, but there are a number of variations in the code. The code is no longer the same. They were not happy with the code not being the same, and they said, well, you found this because it's you, you have experience with this, and so on. I put the student to do this, undergraduate student with zero experience in formal methods, and he's Daphne, and I gave him, here's the code, go find it. He found not only the same specification as I did, he actually run it on all inputs possible because this is 0255, 0255, 65,000 options. You just wrote a program that run both alongside each other and then plot the graph between the two, and there are about 300 places where our code does the right thing and their code does the wrong thing. We didn't even try it on different compilers, but the point there being, you can't say it's too difficult. If an undergraduate student has zero experience did it in 3 months, why can't you? So it's social tech, it's a resistance, if you like, to change. The actual code here is relatively simple. Some if the analysis for the case that the delta is to one side to the other side, and you deal with it, not in the negative number case. But yeah, that's the gist of it. You know, communication factor 13 bits, the address is 3 bits, the converter is 3 bits. So what hard are you talking about? 7 options. What are you telling the hard to do? Is it push it down, pull it up, and switch it on, switch it off? Or how long, or how fast, and so on. So it was that delta here that they were basically doing that kind of comparison against each other. And effectively that meant we had a handle that was very precise and very clear on the key functionality of the whole machine. And this is about 7 lines, you see. Eventually we gave them a report that told the bugs that were in there, the things that were visible, these were things, and they appreciate this. So what's the timeline? Where are we with this? So this is the Kidman MacGyver, his idea in 2008, the design in 2008-15, the actual machine in 17, being certified, and now it's a product by Allman. It's being bought out, and yeah, they're making money. So this was a very pleasing exercise, particularly being the case that it was in the very world Nina was, so that was kind of nice. So that was the first story. The second one is about a brain pacemaker called Kendu. I forgot that it's abnormal. I forgot what happened in 74, but what they do is really science fiction, first time I heard. They exchange electrical signals for light signals. So they put an electrode in the brain or an electrode array, and they pick up the electrical signals from this, it goes to a chest unit, figure out what is going on, and sends back a counter signal to counteract what's going on in the brain. from getting. There are available pacemakers for brain. I've seen the movies of this. It's very interesting. You get a guy with Parkinson's shaking like this, and then you switch on the machine, and then he starts to slowly get okay. The other time, and this works, and it's already available, and so on. And that's a electrical signal input to electrical signal output from the balance of the interface that's coming. Parkinson's is low voltage, so it's okay. Epilepsy is a big spike. So if you give a similar technology, a big spike the other way around, the guy goes blind or loses consciousness depending on where the seizure happens in the brain. So that's why they want light instead of electricity. But brain cells are not light sensitive, so they had to create a virus, and the virus infect the brain cells with the virus. The virus disease is genetically from some algae, and the brain cells become light sensitive. That's what I understand. but then light emits heat, and then you can't switch the lights and leave it on for long, because if you do, you fry the brain. And that's bad. And the brain is a funny organ, because differently from all other organs, it's inside the so-called dura, which is a kind of membrane, and it lives in its own environment. So the immune system is separate. So if you piece the dura, and you have to, and this gets infected for some reason, the immune system will fight the brain and kill it as an invading body. So there are, this project is absolutely fascinating, because you have biology, viruses, materials, how this gets to adhere to the tissue, piece the brain, right brain, blah, blah, blah. Software in this is very low in the priority pecking order. But in the end, this is what's going to control everything. So the control is in three layers. You have control of each individual light on each individual electrode, and then on the electrode array. There are 14 of these in the pack. So you get one control in one electrode, the control of the electrode pack, and then the control of the pack by the control unit. And basically different levels of abstractions of what you want to achieve, which is the counterintuitive of the epileptic seizure spike. We worked on the control system for the individual electrodes, the first unit in this. But the plan is to work out our way to the electrode array and then to the control unit before certification. This is under development now, and meant to do human trials in 2022. They are doing now primate trials. And they have done already mice trials. So that basically means induce a seizure and CP prevents it. So again, we verified they have to produce a purpose-built microchip with a particular command set, APIs, and there is a low-level state machine, about 3,000 lines of C, that verifies that controls this. We didn't verify the libraries, because this is printed hardware, so you kind of have your VHDL thing, have a printer, and it prints the circuit board as it required, and then it spits out the device driver and some library dependencies. We didn't verify this. We verified the controller that uses the device driver, that says switch on the light, switch off the light, diagnosis or whatever. So we were looking for invariants and unreachable states, again, same thing. And invariants there were things like, you know, if you're a send state, you must be arriving at a receive state. If you are an error state, you must pass through reset. If you are a packet creation state, you must tell a continue event, because to create the packet, you need to send it. Things like that. As we analyzed the whole thing, and this was work with a master's student. And again, by the way, when we first interacted with them, we were like, no, we know what we're doing, this is fine. And they really knew what they're doing as well, and it was fine. But still, we found that there was, never mind, this is the actual finite state machine, but the point is, this is the start. And then you say, what do you want to do? Oh, I want to switch on the lights, okay? And then you tell me, this is a dwindling state. Never, it would never start here, and therefore never reach this. And this was important functionality. And the reason why, it was a copy and paste error on the table, which is in C, imagine a kind of a C array of numbers, and copy and paste the wrong column, and get this constant. This one was the wrong signal sent, and this one was the wrong treatment of errors. Bottom line was, okay, that's a copy and paste error, and arguably shouldn't have happened. This one was, oh well, we haven't developed everything about the errors yet, so that's why it's there. We didn't know it, but we're not surprised. And this one was a surprise. We said, oh, really? This wasn't a copy paste in there, so that there was these levels of interactions. The point, though, in the end, was, they're like, right, now we want this stuff. This is interesting. For the next version of the chip, which is going to be the primate one, this was the version for the mice, we want to see and use this and effectively avoid that kind of problem. We started the modeling in C directly, like with the dialyzer, but it was very fiddly because the code here was a bit more low level. And we used BDN instead to abstract away the details and be able to simulate things, test coverage as well, see the original states and so on. And then we modeled it as a map from states to states, so from events to a double map, yeah, a matrix. It's relatively simple. The invariants, there are 20 or some invariants, they were all true of the design. So when we run it on the initial inputs of interest, the invariants held true. Once you fixed those copy and paste errors and other red errors of FSM. Point being, what they've done is was those invariants were true, were germane to what they were trying to achieve, and I checked with them and they were like, yes, that's a good way of putting it. We then, once we identified in VDM what the invariants were, we translated them back to ECD as the corresponding equivalent and verified the state machine for no errors in user compliance. Because this was more critical than the dialyzer, I guess. Well, they're similar criticality, but this one, we took this into Isabel as well, and they're doing this now, an actual proof in Isabel that initialization is true, pre-price post everywhere, and this kind of. The proof for the operations is relatively straightforward because each operation doesn't do that much, but the initialization proof is really hard, it's taking a while. The updated FSM was like this, and then it became like that. So the signal no longer goes down, this is no longer handling, and the error is not important. The other thing we did on this, similar to what happened in the dialyzer, was verification that the package construction is correct. And this is basically telling the machine what to do. Which optional do you want, what do you want it to do, and how long, how time takes, and so on. You construct the packet and you send it to the hardware. This is the actual expression that was in the original code, and this generated like 65 VCs in the C verifier because of a lot of downcasts and upward casts happening in this VP vector operations. We eventually got to just that instead, and okay, it's not, it's a bit more verbose than this, oops, than that one, but it achieves the same. It's basically creating the right addresses in the right order and assembling them against each other. But we pushed upwards to the specification the various, what was, I guess, defensive testing of the masks. And that minimized the VCs from 64 to 8, and that means the time to verification was much smaller, and the complexity of it as well. So we went from 6,000 VCs to 400 and a few, and rather than 10 minutes, it took, I don't know, 50 seconds, 10 seconds to verify. And that again is important because if the guy who doesn't understand this is using it, if it takes 10 minutes and then goes like, ah, right, I did something wrong, not going to do it, not going to engage. Now the actual implementers with a PhD student in the NRA is in the electronics engineering people group, Patrick's group. They are starting to use it themselves, which And so the project started in 2014. I knew about it in 2015, but only got involved in the end of 2015. They now have the design of the electrodes when they print in the circuits and everything. They trial in mice, and they're doing it in primates for human trials in 2020 for a full-blown medical device available in the market by the end of that time. It's very ambitious. Okay, so that's the second one. And finally, the third one, this is going to be a bit faster, I guess, because there isn't much about it. This is organ preservation machine for particularly the pancreas, but it's for a number of organs. So this is under development with blood transplant in Newcastle, NHS. The same people as the dialyzer, incidentally. Not by design, it started with some other people, but then eventually it converged to the same group, which is nice. I'm pretty sure they converted now, so that's great. They buy into this. And it's a organ preservation machine for heart, liver, kidney, pancreas, hand, and face. The focus is on the pancreas to begin with, for a number of reasons, because of the expertise of the team at all, because of the liver team in the Newcastle hospitals, but also because you get 400 million patients worldwide, 10% of the type 1, but it's about 10% of the NHS budget. It's a lot of money. It's projected to be £17 billion a year on treating diabetes in the NHS. So it's 10% of that, so it's £1 billion worth of money. And some of these people can't be managed with medication. They have to have the transplant. But funnily enough, pancreas transplant is not like heart. Heart, you take up a piece of some people put up another piece. A pancreas being a digestive organ, once you die, then it eats itself. So you have to the quality of the organ is different, and you have to basically mash it to a pulp and inject it into the liver. That's how pancreas transplant works. So it avoids that kind of mortality, but it's costly. It costs £25,000 per pancreas transplant, which is basically this mashing up of the organ. But you have to have 33% success rate. So you have 3 pancreas per transplant. And it's 33% success rate within that, which means you have to have, on average, 9 pancreases per patient to get a successful transplant. So it's very costly if you need to find the money. And the reason for that is because the way that the quality of the organ, so the organ comes in low quality and you don't have much time. So if you were to improve the quality of the organ, you were to have more time, then you would mitigate all those costs, basically. And that's the plan. That's why they're doing this. So doing what? We got some funding for the parts and we're going for bigger funding. But basically, at the moment, you put an organ on a cold box, and what the machine will do is oxygenate it. I love the analogy the guy used. When you take an organ for transplant, it's holding its breath. So the longer you wait, the harder it is. So this gives it like an oxygen mask. But the trouble is, it really depends on who is driving. At the moment, current technologies for this, you put the catheter inside the organ, you need to have a specialist there, 24/7 on call, to be able to walk to the site whenever needed. He needs to regulate, or she needs to regulate the machine as well in transit. And what we're doing is creating an algorithm that automates this from the best guy that knows about this, making to an algorithm, which is basically keep the oxygenation pressure and flow under a certain envelope. And it needs to be portable because the current ones, they are 70 kilos, they are enormous, like this big. This ours is meant to be 15. And if you have multiple organs, you don't have space in the theater for all the machines that are needed. It needs to be flexible, so you can reuse the same unit many times. effective integration with the hospital, and you can remote monitor. Imagine in an ambulance or in an airplane, you have 10 or 20 of those organs, and the guy can look at his iPad or whatever, and you check that everything's okay. And it's cheaper. So the point that is, you want to improve transplant outcomes. So the technique there is data to demonstrate that the technique makes you need 1 to 2 pancreas, not 3, and it increases the pancreas functionality by 76%. So you end up having a positive compound effect. So it is therefore less pancreases per transplant needed, and the pancreases are better quality. And rather than 4, you get 24 hours. That means you don't need teams 24/7, because there is one team in Newcastle that covers the whole north of England in Scotland. So if you think about the windows of this, if a guy gives a pancreas in Edinburgh for Cornwall, if a guy gives a pancreas in Salford for the city, you have a chance for real without, for instance. And this makes change the game in that way as well. And we're using off-the-shelf components. The key thing really is in the algorithm. And there were some patents filed for this. The graph there shows this is without persuflation, this is with persuflation in terms of the increase of the organ health. The timeline for this is we started talking about this at the very beginning, and this is great. So I'm participating on the actual conceptual design of the requirements as well as the design of the finite state machine of this. And this is much better earlier. The earlier, as Jose was saying, the better, and that is true of this. The design itself would be a box like this, where you then put the consumable you need here for different organs, and it's the same box that does what's needed. And more important, we have the idea for trials for the next few years, but more important, we started the conversation with MHRUs, the regulator, and Intertech, which is a notified body, the people who give you the certificate. We met with them and said, look, you know what certificate, you know what four methods is? No. You know what MISRA subsets is? No. Would you be interested in understanding what it is and how does it work? He said, yeah, why? Well, and then can this participate in the recognition process? Can this be recognized in the certification process? They said, we are open to trade. Give it to us and we'll tell you if yes or no. And then it will be an iterative cycle. And the plan is produce something, give it to them, they'll say, no, how does this link to the hazard, whatever. And then we'll adjust the communication, if you like, to then eventually get to something that is formally verified and regulatory recognized. That's the plan. If you're going to achieve that or not, it's to be seen. But hopefully. So. Right, so to finish on this, you need to be careful not to be lost in translation and all these things. And yes, the stuff we know and love well here within this community works well. It is not a surprise, but finding, first of all, understanding their problem clearly and understanding how the regulation process works is the tricky bit. It's a social technical experiment in the sense that I spent a year just listening. it took a while. You have to have a good collaborator, both in the technical side and the regulatory side. And the ultimate goal is to influence the medical device processes in general and hopefully make of it what you have nowadays in other domains. Because I saw a government paper the other day that is 20% hospital deaths associated with medical devices, 20% of it is software. And different from cars or planes, you get a plane and you die, that's a problem. Go to a hospital and you die, that's okay, that's what it comes. And if you don't have the next ABS system, you can wait a few years, but if you don't have the machine tomorrow, are you happy to kill somebody because of some errors, but at the same time save a number of other people? So the dynamics is quite different. And again, if you're going to do clinical trials, they didn't find the dialyzer error, and that would kill somebody eventually. And so trials is the wrong approach. But then GoCom is dealing with that, because trials is very seriously what's the alternative for staying? I need to be more. And yeah, that's the
questions?
Thanks for the very nice talk, Leo. Very impressive. I'd like to know a bit more of the scalability of the analysis that you carried out. For example, in the case of the infant dialyzer, the safe machine seems relatively complex. So do you do this analysis, do you do global analysis, or do you need to do some kind of compositional
ideally, I wanted to do it compositionally, so do one syringe and then put in parallel composition in CSP with the rest of the stuff. Unfortunately, because I started late in the process, that was the no-no. And because I didn't understand the machine well enough, I couldn't simply take it apart and put it back together. Arguably, I can do that now. And I found one student that started doing this, but he wasn't up for it. But say, if I got the right student, I guess I could do that, a re-engineering of the machine, now that I know exactly how it works, with that kind of mentality. But given what I had, I need to basically tackle the bull by the horns and deal with the ugliness of how things work. Not compositional, repeated.
As it was feasible in terms of...
It was through writing design-specific, well, domain name. So I basically wrote up small parser for CSV, and then embedded into the parser semantic rules of the invariants, and then had a, if you know of Antler and string template, they are grammar based, both parsing and printing, and that means I could embed in a few lines shortly enough to make all the DBN that I needed to make all the C boilerplate that I needed, so it scales. But it is on a kind of a cottage industry basis, if you like.
Did you need to use concurrency at all? Or?
In the dialyzer, no, because it's single-threaded. Arguably, there is some concurrency going on underneath it, but the time scales are so, it's you can arguably discretize it, but in the brain pacemaker case, I guess there will be concurrency, but that's kind of not in the cards yet. And some of what I was looking about mode or well, in CSP, it would be good to work that, yes. But the code is single threaded. So, you know.
More questions?
So that was a great talk. And you began by saying there's no royal road. You want that to be the takeaway. But for me, the takeaway is that you need to look for solutions, like regulatory process. That seems really interesting. Could you say a little bit more about that? Because you had one line about how you did it, and for the last one, you're saying we're going to need to do it.
Yes, okay, fair enough.
But
so I'll tell this with this story. In the MHRA, when you're there, you're saying, okay, so if you're going to have a box, this was for the organ preservation machine. If you're going to have a box, the point was, if you're going to have different boxes that you plug and play, is it different certifications needed for the organs at hand, right? So the difference between the organs is just the flow, the pressure and flow that you want to keep. So when you start the conversation, these were three or four people in the room. One was about devices, the other was medical, the other was legal, but they were talking about, the liquid is a medical device because it needs to be whatever grade, whatever. The oxygen needs a medical device as well. The secretary needs to go through this safety regulation, blah, 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 blah. And then it was my turn. I said, how about the software? I said, no, the software is fine. I said, what do you mean? Does it mean that if you change the parameters, it's the same code that will, if you change the parameters, deliver to a different organ? Is that something that the certified said? I pass. We don't know. This is, I guess that's the notified body's problem. We as the regulators only care that this is classified under 6.3.4 plus C because blah blah blah. And on the purpose case, if you miss the window, you can wait for the next one, and that's fine. In the hard case, you say, hi, I'm going. The surgeon on the other side opens the guy up,
take the whole heart out and you're waiting. If something happens in between, you kill them. Whereas the pancreas, it isn't. So what's the classification? So they were bogged down on this. In the afternoon, we went to talk to the trial body, and they said, same story. And they're like, pass. It's the regulator's problem. I said, no. They told it's yours. No. They fall back to the same position. Oh, it's what's in the regulation. The regulation says it's a class, whatever. I said, okay, as soon as class C then, okay, so then what? Is it to a different software? Well, they are oblivious. They are basic. Oh, the clinical evaluation will get it. You see? No, it won't. So it's oblivion. And breaking through that oblivion is the deal here. And that's difficult because they know they're talking about. If it comes across as I know better, you're out. So it really can't. So it's difficult in that sense. But once you identify the problem and you bring it to them, like, so what are you going to do with this? Then they start to listen. So the point is to write a paper on this, actually, on the social technical aspects, but when do I submit that too? I don't know.
Well, there is an announcement about next 6 minutes.
The what?
Dewbert
Campton, yeah. Oh, I see. Yeah, it was funny if it wasn't tragic.
If you give them this line about 20% of deaths are software related, do they care?
Not quite, no. And if you say that directly, the answers tend to be, maybe the classification was wrong. Oh, I didn't know about that. Oh. And again, I'll give another example. The notified bodies do things differently. So for the dialyzer, for instance, they had a technical file with everything they needed to know is about the syringe is in here, everything they need to know about the pump is in here, and so on. The actual regulator they went to wanted, I want all things electrical here, all things physical there, all things mechanical there. And then now you have this slice and dice exercise, and go re-engineer thousands of pages of documents, it's really detailed. So it's potluck on the one hand, or if you get somebody like them early on and they are happy with it, you can kind of convince them as you go along, but yeah, there is no road. There is reason for that. You don't want to say you must do it in this way. The major told us, well, a chair that takes a guy from A to B is a medical device. A dialyzer is a medical device. A computer comes a medical device. A CT scan is a medical device. And the regulation over them all. An EpiPen, so for instance, the pharmaceutical companies are taking notice of all this, I think, more than others, because they don't want egg in their faces and they don't do devices, but EpiPens that are clever or measure everything that you can measure about the person, how he's leaking, how much exercise he's done, right? So I know how much insulin they should take. That's a medical device done by a pharmaceutical company and they don't want to get messed up by making a mistake. So it's difficult, but I guess now after a few years of understanding their language and how they, what makes them tick, it's getting there. But by the way, all this is pretty much without funding. I applied for funding with a star team in my mind. You know, it was me, Cliff Jones, Jim Woodcock, and another couple of country, with the R&D people for the dialyzer and the devices to come. This was in 2015. We got three sixes, and one guy's comment killed it. He said, well, what's the difference between that and an embedded box of a car? So I don't see the research contribution to this. And then the product was killed. And then all this is funded basically on extra work, no money at all. Now finally, money is, so the can-do case, they have their own money. They're not paying anything. The best thing they did was to pay for some students over summer. Right? But that's it. It's pro bono time. This one, we managed to get some funding, but again, the funding in the medical world is very different. An hour for 5 years? For 3 years? What do you mean? You mean he's going to be working on 3 or 4 different projects, is it? No, no, just for me. No. So, but how do you get somebody 33% of the time, 3 years to do this? Right? You can't. Right. So, it's tricky.
I mentioned it was a nice talk. Obviously, the user interface is a very important part of this kind of device, and you've been focusing on how to prove mostly state machines within the device. How do you prove that when the nurse or the doctor press a button on the user, on the apparatus, on the device, that that specific, the function that should be called is actually called? How do you make the link from the user interface to the code?
So at the moment the answer is we haven't, but the work Michael Harrison does is exactly on that kind of thing, making sure that the interfaces are correct and sound with respect to the intention, the intended behavior. So in a way we are going enough, because I don't understand interfaces well enough to figure out that this button should be here, or so the key button, for instance, in the dialyzer there are 2 user buttons, key 1 and key 2. In some cases, key 1 was a positive answer, key 2 was a negative answer, and in other cases was the other way around, and that could be confusing. That kind of thing. I don't have an eye for it, right, as much as Michael Harrison does, but yeah, he's working on on this one as well. Can do won't have a button. Well, the button of can do will be something you bring close to the control unit, and then it does as much. So less international, but you're right. It's a work to do. Yeah.
I think we have time for one more question before we go. If there are none, then let's go for this great talk. There is an announcement about the next SBNF. So, yes, about the next SBNF, we had a meeting on Wednesday, and we decided to go for São Paulo. The plan is to have about the same period of this year, so the plan is yet to be confirmed, but the plan is to have it between this coup happening 25th and 26th, and then the SBNF happened there from 27th to 29th of November. And as I said, the SBNF will be in São Paulo. So it's very near Rio de Janeiro as well. So we can take maybe half an hour flight to Rio de Janeiro. But São Paulo is the biggest city in Brazil. It's one of our metropolis, as we have like 12 million inhabitants in São Paulo. Temperature is a little bit lower than here in this period, so we will be something, so this is now, so we have something like 20-25 degrees. As I said, it's a big city, it's a metropolis, so lots of buildings, but also nice, very nice city parks to enjoy. So this is the biggest one, this Ibirapuera. It's like the main avenue of São Paulo. And the city market, but better than pictures, a very short video.
yes, it's yes, that's consequence. So it is the biggest city in Brazil, and there is no beaches, but there is a lot to be done there. And it's very, very easy to get there. It's the main hub, it's the main air hub in Brazil. So lots of flights to America, to Europe, and hotel is not a problem there. So this is just a small, if you zoom in, you get much more. So you have like hundreds of hotels there. So it's not. The venue will be at USP, Universidade de São Paulo. This is a photo of the campus at the Instituto de Matemática e Estatística. So we will be again in a IME, in the Instituto de Matemática e Estatística, like this one here. But USP is a very large, AUCAS is the largest university in Brazil. So they have 8 campus. One of them is the São Paulo one, and it's a huge university with about almost 6,000 lecturers and almost 100,000 students. And it's also considered to be the best university in Brazil. So this is a ranking on one of the most famous newspapers in Brazil, called São Paulo. And USP was considered the top university in Brazil. And then the computer science course considered to be the second best computer science course in Brazil. So it's also a good opportunity for collaboration, to find collaborations in Brazil. It will be organized by Dr. Anna Mello. She's a lecturer at IME in the USP. And the PC chairs will be Dr. Philip Wadler from Edinburgh and Adolfo Duran. They are co-chairing the program committee of SBMAP 2019. So for further information, all information will be provided by that link there. So this is a Brazilian Computer Society event. And that's all. So I hope to see you all in São Paulo next year. Thank you.
So now we go for coffee break and we reconvene at 11 o'clock.
is on a base. Excellent. Thank you for the presentation.
Thank you very much. So good morning, everyone. So I'm going to be talking about this AMU verification. So it falls under the category of hardware verification. So I've organized the talk in this manner. So first of all, a little bit of introduction about the topic, the AMU and why we're trying to verify it, the methodology that we've proposed, some modeling and verification details, and finally conclusion. So AMU, as we all know, it's a very frequently used component in hardware design. It's an integral part of every processor that is fabricated. Actually, it is used to perform different logical and arithmetic operations like addition, multiplication, and many others. So usually an OLU has two operands, and then you have some opcode which selects one of the operations, and then you get the answer as a result. As I said, this is very frequently used in many hardware designs. So these ALUs are fabricated in chips, and then, they can be found in all sorts of applications, ranging from smartphones to smart cars and many others. Now, because of the Moore's law, we all know that we are packing more and more transistors in a given area. And that's why the complexity of hardware design has been continuously on the rise. This has brought big challenges for the verification. Now, if we our scope is on ALUs, so if you look at ALUs and the verification techniques that have been used to verify these ALUs, so they can be broadly classified into three categories: voltage checking, automatic Turing proving, and interactive Turing proving. Now, considering the sizes of ALUs that we have these days, voltage checking definitely is an automatic technique, but it's going to definitely face explosion problems because of the huge size of ALUs. Like these days, we're talking about 56 bits and beyond ALUs. So model checking is definitely going to be somewhat limited in that manner. On the other side, interactive Turing proving is again automatic, but again, it has many computational issues when we deal with large designs, and that's why we are again limited when we talk about ALUs. Interactive Turing proving, on the other hand, is capable of verifying generic expressions. When I say generic, it means you do not even need to specify the number of bits. You can verify an expression which is quantified over all the n bit values, and so that's the strength of Turing proving. But on the other hand, it needs a lot of manual guidance to verify Turing. And definitely, this means that all these main techniques are not very savvy to the industry of usage. The people really want to have push button like tools. They just press the button and then they get the verification. Now we propose to use higher logic Turing proving, and the methodology that we have proposed somewhat minimizes the user interaction in the proofs for verifying n-bit ALUs, and that's what we're going to be using here. So the idea is that we verify interactively all the basic components that are used in the ALU. So they range from all the basic circuit elements like logic gates, adders, multipliers, encoders, decoders, multiplexers, demultiplexers. So these are the foremost components that are usually used in your ALU design. So we actually verify their generic expressions beforehand. Obviously, this verification is going to be done interactively because there are generic expressions would need to have induction and other things. So once they are verified, then what we do is that we take the structural view of my ALU because I already have these components formalized. So I can use these models to construct the implementation view of my ALU. Similarly, I can get the behavior and write my formal specification for it. And then I verify an equivalence theorem in the sound environment of a Turing prover based on these components that were already formalized. So when I say formalized, it means that we not only model them, but we also verify their behavior. So their behavior is already known to the Turing prover. So now this verification, we believe, is going to be much easier compared to start something from scratch. So that's the methodology, and in the end we would really have an expression which relates the implementation that we have to the required specification. So that's the methodology, and I'm going to be giving you some details about it so that we understand how this really works. So we started with you know, small gates. So let's say this is the inverter, so that's our implementation of an inverter. That's the function. It takes two arguments, A and out. A is the input, out is the output. And as you can see, it's a predicate. It just sees that out is equal to the negation of the input A. Similarly, we formalize n bit gate. So if you look at this definition, so this AND function actually takes the list. It's a recursive definition because it's a generic AND gate. If the list is empty, you return 2. On the other hand, if there are elements, so you keep adding the elements until you exhaust the whole list. And similarly, we have a predicate form of this function form where out is equal to AND. So similarly, we can, you know, formalize all the other commonly used gates, and we actually made sure that we have generic expressions. I mean, this definition can cover 3 input, 4 input, or any other input gates. Now we come to more, you know, complex components. So let's talk about the MUX. So this is a MUX, and a multiplexer actually either selects one of these two inputs. So it's a two-input MUX. You have the select line. If the select line, if it says 0, so it would select A, otherwise it would select B. So this is the specification of the MUX. It takes, it has 3 inputs, A, B, and S, and then Y is the output. So the specification, you know, takes these arguments. If S is 2, then Y is assigned the value of B, else Y is equal to B. So that's the simple specification of a MUX. Now this is the implementation of the MUX. So this is the way here, but this is how we implement it in Boolean logic. So we also formally actually modeled this implementation. And as you can see that it has 3 NAND gates and 1 inverter. So in our definition, you know, for this inverter we have this NOT. S is the input, P is the output. You have one NAND gate, so this NAND N, our previous definition that was described in the last slide. It has a list, so the list tells you that it is a two-input NAND gate because it has 2 elements. And then Q is the output. Similarly, we model the second NAND gate and the third NAND gate, and that's how we capture the behavior of the implementation. So it's the structural view of how you would represent a MUX. So now we have the specification, we have the implementation. The next thing is that we verify their equivalence within a terminal. So that's how, this is the basic component MUX. Now we extend the library because we also want to verify a generic version of the multiplexer. Now this is more complicated. Here you have, as an input, you can have n inputs because you have to select any one of these n inputs, which is going to be in the form of a list. You have one output because you just select one of the possible inputs. For the select lines, you have k select lines, and this is the relationship between the select lines and the number of inputs. So if it's a 4-to-1 MUX, the number of select lines is going to be 2, and similarly it goes on. So that's the generic MUX that we want to now formally verify. And for that, the first thing is to formally specify the behavior of this MUX. So for that, again, this A is a list, S is also a list because these are not single input things. B is a single output, so it's a Boolean variable. So this is my specification, takes A, S, and B, and this is how it's related. So as you can see, I just select one of the elements, so EL is the function in Hall 4 which selects one of the elements from this list. So B is equal to one of the elements of A, and how this element is selected. So actually, we take the length of A minus 1 because we're actually going from 0 to n minus 1. And then bit value n is a function that we wrote which actually converts a Boolean list to its corresponding integer value. And that's its implementation. As you can see, it recursively actually gives you the integer value of the Boolean list. So let's take a quick example to understand this. Let's say that I want to select the 0th element from the MUX. So I would give 0 here. So the Boolean value of that S is going to be 0. Let's say if it's a 4-to-1 MUX, so it's going to be 4 minus 1 minus 0. So the third element is going to be returned. And the third element is the 0th element. That's how we have organized things. So now we have our specification. Now we also have to model its implementation, and now this was the most challenging part to get these generic implementations of these hybrid components. So that's how we have done it. So it's a recursive definition. As you can see, that we start with if there is no select line, it means there would be one input because there is no select line. So V is just assigned the head element of the input list. In the step case, now we have, first of all, let's try to understand. So we are using this two input mux to actually create this n bit mux. So that's our base component. So at every iteration, we actually insert a two input mux. So this definition mux imp is actually the implementation of the two input mux. So every time you insert a two input mux, and then you recall the function using this. These arguments. Now half is nothing but it divides the length of the list by half. So it takes the list A, divides it into half, and then we drop the first part in this case and take the next part in that case. So let's say if it's a four input thing, so we would divide it into two halves, like 2 bit long each. So you see this one corresponds to this mux and this one corresponds to that mux. So similarly, it's a recursive definition, keeps calling it itself. And then you keep on inserting these two input muxes, and then you create that n bit structure using multiple two input muxes, and that's how we have the generic one. So once we get our implementation done, so next thing is to verify the equivalence between the implementation and the specification. So we have both models, and as you can see, this theorem was verified in the Hall 4 theorem prover. We have two assumptions here. First of all, the assumption says that the select line list cannot be empty because otherwise there's no point in having a mux. Secondly, the length of the input vector has to have this relationship with the select lines. As we said, we already know that this is something that is required for a mux. So based on that, we verified that, and again, the verification was interactively done. It was based on, we did induction on variable S, which is actually a list. And then there were three lemmas that were actually verified in order to verify this result. Now let's try to understand these lemmas. So the first one, I'm trying to make an equivalence between two elements of two different lists. So the first list is A. So let's say this is my A, the blue one, and the red one is take MA, which means I take first M elements of the list A. And I say that their nth element is going to be equal only if I have taken M elements, and n is less than m, and the value of m is also less than 2k. So that's how we verify this theorem. This is the second one. Again, if I drop m elements from a list A, then the n plus 1 index of this guy is going to be equal to the element n of that guy. And similarly, this one says the bit, the integer value of list A is always going to be less than the 2s power length. So these were the three lemmas that actually the theorem prover asked us to verify in order to verify the equivalence relationship, and those were interactively done, and finally we were done with this verification. Now on similar lines, we had to verify all the components. So I just wanted to give you the example of the mux, but similarly other components, the most commonly used ones were verified, like this is the decoder. This is the demultiplexer. So actually, all the theorems are very similar. You have the implementation model, you have the specification model, you have the equivalence between them, and then there is a bunch of assumptions. Similarly, we verified encoders, the n-bit model of an adder was verified, n-bit model of a multiplier was also verified as part of our library. So this library was then complete. The whole verification took about 7,000 lines of Hall code, and also it took about 2,009 hours. So a lot of effort was actually spent also to identify these generic versions of the circuits. To our knowledge, this was not available in the literature. So we had to come up with these models so that we verify these generic models. We had to formally model them. Then suppose you get the circuit, you model them, and then you verify. So all effort included in this 2009. So once we have this library, the good thing is that now we can build on top of this library, and as per our methodology, we can now implement. Yes.
Is it two
2,000 man months, and you said hours, which is
it's man hours. Sorry, not man months. Yeah.
2,000 man months was a very big part.
Yeah. This, I don't know. It's man hours. I'm sorry about that. Yeah. Okay, so this is our library. Now we have to use it to, because we have all the formal definitions now. So writing the implementation of the ALU is just going to be using these definitions. Similarly, specification can come, and then we can have a theorem of equivalence, just like we have been doing with other circuits, and then we can give it to a theorem prover and find a theorem, I guess.
Does it always have to be?
It could be an implication as well, but equivalence is strong, so that's why we always went for the strong result. But it could be implication. So we picked one of the recently verified ALU units. This was verified using automatic theorem proving techniques, and the authors claimed that it took them 35 seconds to verify a 256-bit ALU, same design. But you can see the exponential rise in the time. And beyond 256, they couldn't go because the time was too much to handle in terms of computation cost. Now this ALU is an industrial level ALU. It takes three inputs. You know, this MUX is used to negate it, so I mean, you have A minus A, B minus B, C minus B, and then they do a bunch of, you know, calculations in order to give you all the possible combinations of these three inputs. So you can compute all these based on the select lines of the multiplexes. So we took the same design because we wanted to compare our approach with this existing work. So that's our model, as we know that it uses a MUX with a negative input, so we actually model this component using our existing MUX and in the NOT gate first. Then we have three of these components, which you can see here. Then you have the multiplier, then you have the AND gates, and then you have the adder. So we already have all these components, it's just a matter of, you know, instance, I mean, using them in this definition. So very straightforward definition. Once we get that, then we have to write the big specification because we have all the different values coming on depending on the values of the multiplexes, like either you use the positive value or the negative value. So this is the whole specification, which actually represents what this the behavior of this module. Once we have these two, then we verify this theorem. So this is the result. As you can see, the implementation corresponds to the specification. For the assumptions, they are very simple, so the length of all three operands must be same, and they have to be greater than zero as well. So once we get this theorem, I mean, this is the whole you know, script that was used to verify this. And as you can see, the script is very, very straightforward. We just remove the quantifiers, then we rewrite with the specification of the ALU. And the rest is all the definitions of the components that have been used in this implementation, as well as the theorems corresponding to the relationship between their implementation and the specification. So we just used those theorems, and you know, it was done in a fraction of a second, actually. So very fast. So this brings me to the conclusion of the talk. So actually, with the current increase in the transistors on a small area, we have a lot of high bit ALUs coming up, and to our knowledge, there is no verification approach that can actually deal with this. So we actually proposed this theorem proving based approach, and we used it to verify and generic model of an industrial ALU. The good thing about our approach is that even though this is based on an interactive theorem proving tool, but you know, based on the support that we have built, based on all the generic versions of the components that we have verified, the verification of the n-bit ALU is pretty straightforward. So we are still working on extending this approach. We want to have more advanced adders and multipliers in our library so that you know, even ALUs with those designs can also be verified. And we also want to go for you know, larger and more complex ALU models, including the ones that are used for floating point. So thank you very much for your attention.
Great. Paxton. Well, I am looking to comment about the recent, say, the paper that you sent to incorporate model check and the methodology.
Yes, that's another future direction that we want to explore. So far, our components are all based on combination logic. So we do not cater for sequential components like flip-flops, registers, and all. So we want to integrate model checking in this approach. And the idea is that, because a digital circuit is composed of flip-flops, and then you have a cloud of logic in between, which is composed of combination logic. So we verify the equivalent behavior of that cloud of combination logic. And then this is how we simplify the whole netlist, and then we give this model to a model checker to verify, to look at the whole design. So that's another extension that we need to explore.
Okay. And about, when the Apache library, you have a proof searching or
No, this is all done interactively. This is like really manual stuff. Yeah.
And you comment about scalability of the.
Yeah, for the scalability, because we are already verifying all the generic models. So we believe that if there is, like all the components of your ALU are existing in our library, then the verification is going to be, very easy, just like in the case of the example that we saw. Yes, actually all the models are available on our application space.
So, thank you again. Now we invite Philip Water to give a second presentation. Programming Language Foundation in Canada from the University of Ebon, Scotland.
So this is why I don't like practice, why I prefer theory. I'm wearing a little lambda pin. Right? Lambda pin's very good. It's made of metal. A student made it for me. My daughter made this for me. It's a fuzzy lambda. But I need a lambda fuzzy toy. And this, I think, is how we should think about theory, right? Theory is our fuzzy friend. Right? Cuddle it. I'm going to talk about programming language foundations in ACA. This is a textbook that I wrote recently. I wrote it in Rio de Janeiro. You can see the streets of Rio de Janeiro are paved with lambdas. More than one. That's me actually sitting in the kitchen working on this book. So it's called Programming Language Foundations in ACA. People who know me know that I like puns. Can you tell the pun in that title?
It's ambiguous.
And what's the ambiguity?
You can be programming language foundation. You can put parentheses in language foundation.
Right. So most people read it and think, it's about programming language foundations in ACA. But the key thing about ACA is it uses type theory as a proof assistant. So that means it's just an ordinary dependently typed functional language. But everything is guaranteed determinate. So when you write a recursion, it must be structurally recursive. So if you want to define a pair type, that's straightforward. You do it just like you would in Haskell. If you want to do a proof of a conjunction, that's the same thing. Because to prove a conjunction, you just have a pair of first. How many people here have heard of the idea of propositions as types? Not everybody. Okay. So I need to skip ahead. Skip to the extra bonus slide. People haven't heard about propositions as types.
But you could do two.
Right. There we go. So the idea of propositions as types is, right? Here's a proof rule for a conjunction. You proved A, you proved B, you proved A and B. Here's the proof rule for using a conjunction. You proved A and B, you proved A, or you proved B. But here's the rule for pairs. N is a term of type A, and N is a term of type B. Then NN is an AB pair. And if L is an AB pair, you take its first projection, which is an A, or second projection, which is a B. You can see the blue bits of those rules are exactly identical. So there's no difference between talking about conjunction and talking about the pair type. And it goes further than that, because you've got a correspondence between propositions correspond to types. A proof of a proposition corresponds to a program or a term that has that type. And furthermore, if you look at simplification of proofs, that exactly corresponds to normalization of type. It's this very nice idea. Curry had a version of it back in the 30s. The intuitionists had a version of it back in the 20s. Robert Howard wrote it down in the very late 60s and was published in Curry's Special in the 80s. It's often called the Curry-Howard isomorphism. Who's heard of that name? Right. De Bruijn had a similar idea independently. So many people say, well, you actually should name it after Brauer-Heiden and Kolmogorov, or after De Bruijn. So I've stopped giving up. I've given up on calling it the Curry-Howard isomorphism. I now call it propositions of this type, so that you don't need to argue about who gets credit. Is that a clear enough introduction for everybody? So, ACA is based very solidly on this idea, so that a proof of a conjunction is the same as pairing, a proof of a disjunction is the same as a disjoint subtype, and a proof by induction is just the same as a recursive proof. So that's the key. But what that means, I've now told you enough to explain the pun. Because you could view it as we're talking about programming language foundations in ACA, but what are your proofs? Your proofs are just programs of an appropriate type corresponding to the proposition that you're proving. So the other way we take this is we're taking language foundations and we are programming them in ACA. So how many people have heard of the book Software Foundations? A few of you. So
there was a tutorial actually in the conference.
Software Foundations is available online, about a number of volumes. The key thing that I'm interested in is to discuss the programming language foundations. You know, read that. And I'll show you a proof from this chapter, the main properties of the simple type lambda calculus. First property of this is progress. Conjunction tactics, so you're trying to prove a conjunction, you whack, break it into two smaller things to be true. So two A and B, right? You've got this zombie A and B shuffling towards you. You hit it on the head, whack, that turns into two smaller zombies, right? One called A and one called B. And you keep hitting it on the head until it gets small enough. There's a shotgun called reflexivity. You can blow it away with that. Reflexivity is just to prove that A equals A. It's great, it's just like a video game when it finally says you're done with the proof. So all of this is great about Koch, but what's bad about it is you need to teach the students about these proof tactics. So instead of just, here, you know about pairs, it's both, here, you know about the pair type, but also, here are the tactics for dealing with conjunctions. So there's a tactic for breaking it into two bits, and then if you have a conjunction, there's a tactic that says, well, use the left bit or use the right bit. So if you look at this proof of progress, the progress says for every term of a type, if in the empty context the term has a type, then either that term will be a value or there'll be some other term that the first term reduces to the second term. And then here's the proof written out for the little lambda calculus they got in English. And then they've got this little plus sign. If you click on it, that shows you the actual proof. And this says, oh, we're using E to auto, and then we introduce some variables. Oh, you better remember this thing with the name gamma. And then you do induction on the hypothesis. Do a substitute. I find this very hard to read, even having taught this class for 5 years. And the right way to read it, actually, is you don't read it at all. Instead of an interactive proof environment like this one. So in this interactive proof environment, I can say load the progress theorem, skip over the comment, and then let's do the proof. So this loads in our subgoal, and then intros key, intros all these things. So what that does is it turns this for all into just saying I've got some variables in the environment that have those types. And I've got three things. And then I can say, what's the next step here? Remember something as gamma? I have no idea what that's going to be. Oh, okay, so it introduces gamma, another variable gamma, and it says, well, that's actually the empty variable. And then this says, okay, we're going to do induction on HT, which is this, from gamma to blue, the little T has to have big T, and so on. And then we broke it. Turn our zombie into three zombies shuffling toward us, and we keep going. So you go through, and if you execute the proof interactively, you can see what's going on and understand it. But if you just look at it in a textbook, it's a bit like seeing the record of a chess game and trying to understand the chess game without having a chessboard in front of you that you can play the game on. Some people can actually do chess completely in their heads. I'm not one of those people. So the problem with using Koch is you can't read it very easily. And you have to separately learn not just about the programming language, but also about tactics. So for all these reasons, I was getting more and more anxious. I want to do this using Adler rather than Koch. Let me try this. Now, my first idea is I will take the textbook and I will rewrite it. I'll leave the textbook as it is, and I will change all the proofs to from top to add them. But then after a bit, I thought, actually, I don't like this textbook. I should write my own textbook that I would like. You should never, ever write a book if you can avoid it. But I started doing the adapt, and I quickly thought, no, this is a book I cannot not write. Which, by the way, is the only place classical logic is going to show up in this talk, because we use intuitionistic logic. But I decided I have to write this book. So I wrote my own book, which is here's the book called Programming Language Foundations. It's not a best. And hold on. Yes. It's called Programming Language Foundations. It's an AGA. And it's similar in structure to Software Foundations. And at first I explained enough AGA to do basic logic. First half, and then the second half is actually using it to do stuff with programming languages. Software Foundations does both core logic and simply type lambda calculus. I just do variations on lambda calculus. So here's the chapter again where we prove progress and preservation. And here's the proof of progress. I just want to show you that it's a little bit different. First, give the formal statement, which is very similar. Although, rather than doing it as a disjunction, I can just introduce a new data type, progress, and say, okay, progress holds for n if either there is some n, such that n steps to n, or we have a proof that n is a value. I can then keep these names, step and done, which makes things a little bit easier to read. Either you can take a step or you're done. You take a step if there's some term you can reduce to, you're done if you have a proof that you're a value. And by the way, if I say something you don't follow, please interrupt and ask your question. Are there any questions yet? Okay. So, and then here's the proof written out in AGA. And you can see it's not much larger than the proof in Koch using tactics. And that's very important. Right, Koch has been used for really big things, like the proof of the four-color theorem, or the proof that the top search compiler, which is a compiler to C, is correct. So it's been used for very significant pieces of work. And it's the tactics that make that possible. The tactics, in general, can remove repetitive bits of a proof. So now, I'm writing out all the proofs in full. I don't want to have to teach the students tactics. And the question is, will it work? Maybe the groups get too big. So here's the key thing I learned. It works. The proofs do not get too big. And this is quite typical. So the proof stays about the same size as the proof of tactics. And that's interesting, because the proof of tactics actually skipped over some trivial cases that got automatically proved. Here I'm proving all the cases. But nonetheless, the size is real. You can see it looks quite nice in terms of indentation structure. You can see kind of what the structure of the proof is. And then having given the proof in code, I then go through and explain it in prose, which looks very similar to the explanation given in Software Foundations. But the big difference is they have the code last and hidden, and I have the code first. And that's because in their case, you want to hide the code because you can't read it. The key thing is, yes, it just went through. Koch agreed it was a correct proof. But here you can actually read the code and use that as a guide to understanding how the proof works. My intention is people read the code first and then check that against the English, rather than that you have to read the English first and then look at the code matches. will repeat a lot of what I've said, right? But we've talked, everything has to be done twice when you're teaching. You have to first teach about products and then teach about the tactics connected with disjunction. And the same for everything else. Whereas here, you just do things once. Induction in talk can really be kind of mysterious. You just say, induct on such and so, that gives you a formula, and you go, I look at the formula, I say, where did that come from? Like, the students come to me and say, where did that come from? And I look at it, where did that come from? And fortunately, we've got lots of experts on COP that work in the same corridor I do. So I go down to Brian Campbell's office, I say, where did that come from? And half the time he says, it's obvious, Phil, it's because blah, blah, blah. And the other time he says, I don't know, where did that come from? So it can be rather mysterious. And in fact, this proof of not the proof of progress, the proof of progress and preservation, that was the first thing I did. That's kind of the most important thing. So before writing the book, I did that to see if it would work. And I found out that it did, and then I didn't get into any trouble writing the rest of the book, which was kind of what I expected, having done the most complicated proof. But I did the proof my own on ABDA. I was a complete newbie to ABDA, so it took me 2 days to go through the whole proof. Now I can do it much more quickly. But in the process, I went through, I sort of copied the proof of Talk for Foundations, and then when I was done, I went back and I reread Talk for Foundations, and at one point it's, so the key technique you teach the students is you don't induct on the structure of terms, you induct on the structure of evidence that the term has some property. For instance, you induct on evidence that the term is well typed. So rather than induct on the structure of a term, if you're proving something about well-typed terms, induct on that proof. So that's one of the key lessons, which is emphasized both in Software Foundation and in my textbook. And so I went through, I did my proof, and then I went back, I looked more closely at Software Foundation, and at one point Software Foundation says, actually, here, we're going to induct on the term rather than the proof as a type, because talk goes weird when you try to do the induction. And I had just done it by induction on the proof that it's well typed, and it went through easily. I didn't even notice there was any issue. So that's an example of the way talk can actually get in your way, from projection being mysterious. In talk, they have a very flexible idea of notations. So I first defined this thing, substitute n, the term n for the variable x in the term m. Sorry, other way around. In the term n, replace x by the term m. And the way you want to write that is n with x gets bound to m. So they have notations that let you, so first you define this, then you define the notation, and from thereafter you can use the notation. And there's even a recursive way where you can use the notation in the definition of subs, but you still also have to define subs. First, you have to give two names to this thing, which is annoying and sometimes confusing. In the standard library, the naming conventions can vary widely. Some things have very short names, some things have very long names. And this notion of propositions as types, which I explained to you very quickly, I think that's really an important idea. And in fact, it's ended up being the basis for a lot of my research career. You find an interesting logic, and then look at the corresponding programming language. And in general, it says if you're designing something, since logic, ever since Gensen, breaks up into pairs of rules, either introduction and elimination rules, or left and right rules, those are the ways we usually formulate our logic, that tells us that when you're designing a programming language, what you will have is things that construct values of the type, and things that use or destruct values of the type. And then that should be the way you go about designing your programming language. What are your types? How do you build things of that type? How do you take apart things of that type? So it gives you a model for how to go about designing a programming language. So I think propositions as types is a really important thing for the students to see. And there's sort of one chapter that very quickly talks about propositions as types in Software Foundations, whereas in Programming Language Foundations in AGA, the whole book is about propositions. Series of chapters explaining that in detail. So all these problems go away if you have ABDA. There are no tactics. Turing and conjunction is identical. Induction is exactly the same as recursion. And in fact, the name for this concept is just that sequence of symbols with underbars where the arguments go. That's very nice. The cost you pay for that is notice I had to write some extra spaces in it because ACT is extremely flexible. It's just like Lisp. A name can be any sequence of characters whatsoever, just about only a couple of special ones like parentheses or braces that aren't like that. So you need lots of extra spaces and separate things. The standard library is not perfectly consistent. And indeed, they make changes that break things. So they change the standard library between one version and the next so that stuff using the old version doesn't work anymore. But it's kind of made a stab at consistency. I don't like all the names, but they've made a stab at consistency. And as I mentioned, propositions on types is just the core of how everything works. So you must understand that in order to do any proofs at all. Let me show you what happened. I've been through this, right? So here's the progress in my book, and then here's the same thing in Software Foundation. We've been through that, so I don't think I need to go through that in detail anymore. But the point is, this is rather hard to read. There's a little training, I think this becomes readable. You do not need some interactive tool. So the next thing that I learned, so when I wrote the paper, I called this inherently typed. I've since recalled that there's a nice terminology due to John Reynolds. And there's a nice terminology due to John Reynolds. And he says, he calls these extrinsic and intrinsically typed. I'll use that, those terms for this talk. So, the normal way we present lambda calculus is extrinsically typed. You've got a notion of raw term, and then you have separate typing rules that tell you when a term is well typed. So you present the raw terms, here's what a term looks like, and then you present the typing rules. That's the way we normally do things. Of course, we normally do things with named variables. So you can say that variables like identifier, string like x. The other way to do it is inherently typed or intrinsically typed. The other name for extrinsic typing, sometimes people call it curry typing. So you have a notion of term and you have a separate notion of type. Intrinsic typing says no. In type theory terms, you say the type of terms is indexed on the type of types. So you know the type before you can start to write down the term. And this is sometimes called church typing, or intrinsic typing. And also I'm going to make one other change, which you don't have to make with it, that goes well with it, which is I'll switch from named variables to deploying variables. Pronouncing that wrong. Mood, the variables, but my Dutch is not very good. So two different ways to present things. And I thought, and I knew that there are lots of people in the type theory world who say it's much better to do things intrinsically typed. But the presentation of Software Foundations is extrinsically typed. That's the one that we normally see written out in textbooks and papers. I thought that's the one I'll use. So I did that, and then I was sitting down at a conference with a fellow named David Durai, and I said, I did all this. He said, oh, how long was that? I think, about 1,000 lines. He goes, oh, I have one that's inherently typed, and it's 200 long. What? So I got him to mail it to me, and I looked at it. It was indeed much shorter. So I thought, oh, I have to get into that. So I did it both ways. So if you use named variables and separate types, so this is extrinsic. So these are comparable lines, but I took away all the examples because those are my bar. Just the basic definitions you need and the basic theorems. It's 451 lines for the basic definitions of theorem. But if you use De Bruyne indices and inherently typed or intrinsically typed, it's 275 lines. You take the ratio, 451 over 275 is 1.6, 275 over 451 is 0.6. These differ by about one, and hence that is indeed the golden ratio. Yes?
Can you give an example of those extrinsically typed and
the beginning of the development. This is the beginning of the development. As you can see, it's rather small print. But here I'm defining the lookup rules for a variable in an environment. And here I'm defining the typing rules. And here's the definition of terms. So I define terms, and then types and contexts for typing. And then what it means to look up a variable in the context, what it means for a term to be about typing. And then you'll go on and do the rest of the development.
And this is intrinsic.
This is extrinsic because I've got a separate notion of term, and here a term having a type. Notice that when you're looking up a term in an environment, there are basically two possibilities, a variable in an environment. Either the variable is right at the end of the environment, or the thing at the end of the environment differs from the variable you've got to look down. So there are two cases. And this is the base case for determining. I've named these suggestively Z and S because go to the inherent formulation. Those are just the rules for dealing with zero, which means you've got the variable right at the end of the environment, or something greater than zero, which means you have to step down in the environment. So the typing rules turn into the Freudian distance, which is rather nice. And so now I've defined types and context and looking up a variable in the context, and then I can define terms, but define each term as having a type. So the term is defined by its typing. So there's no longer a difference between a term and a type derivation. And you can see it's a little bit shorter, there's less to do, and that gets repeated in the rest of the derivation. Also, it turns out that this Conner McBride has a really nice way of doing substitution, which works perfectly here, does not work so well with named variables. So there are many things that are nicer about this way. There's also one thing that's not nicer, which is I haven't done this yet, like the book and the description of pure type systems, which model dependent type, so if the students see a model of the programming language they've been using throughout the course, that would be a good thing to do. It turns out that doing a intrinsically typed version of pure type systems is challenging, in that I don't know anybody who's done it yet. Conner McBride and James Chapman are the world experts at this. I've been working with both of them, and we haven't done it. But I'm hopeful that it can be done. We'll see. If it can't be done, then that means I'll have to do half the book extrinsically and half the intrinsically. What I do now is I begin with extrinsic typing so they can see the way it's normally done, and because named variables and lambda calculus are hard enough. And then after that, I redo it with the Freudian indices and intrinsic typing. But they can then see the Freudian indices. And then because it's so much shorter, all the variations on simply typed lambda calculus I give them are done intrinsically typed. So the last thing I want to mention, is one thing that you'd like to have if you're going through all the trouble doing a formal model, 5 minutes. One thing that you'd like to have if you're doing a formal model is a way of animating your calculus. Right? I've formally defined lambda calculus. All right, can I actually prove that 2 plus 2 reduces to 4? You'd like to be able to do that. You want an animator. Now, right? Normally, for animation is extra work, like in talk, in software foundations, they do it by introducing these additional tactics, and then by using the tactics, you can finally reduce a term. So this is showing reduction steps for plus constant 3 and plus of the constant 3 and the constant 4. So that reduces to 3 plus 4 reduces to 7, and then 3 plus 7 reduces to 10. So it doesn't show. But I don't have tactics. So what I have is something that I call KNV. So K is a system done by Gregor Rosu, one of Jose's colleagues. And in K, you just write down the reduction rules, and then you get an animator. There's another system called RedX that does this. right, that you have to use one of these systems. Right, so here's a particular paper on big steps in management. It says, so they're doing the comparison. They say, you know, in small step approaches, you can sometimes get an animation for reduction. And then they cite Grigori's work on K and Robbie Findler's work on RedX, and that's it. So, right, you need some kind of specialized system like K or RedX. So I describe this, since I work with Grigori, I describe this as K-editing. If I have K-editing, right, how do I get an animator? K has an animator. That's a great idea. How do I get an animator? And you find other places, like back in 2005, they issued something called the Poppelmark Challenge. And one challenge was write proofs of preservation and progress. And another challenge was do an animator for this particular calculus. So I was gobsmacked when I realized that the answer to my question is completely obvious. It's entirely obvious, but it's not widely known in the community for some reason. I wrote to people in the community. I said, look, you know, is this published anywhere? And they said, no. So the answer is just that the answer is just we prove progress and we prove preservation. What does progress say? Progress says either you're done, you've got a value, or you can take a reduction step. It's a constructive proof. So the proof is a program that will tell you which of those two things hold. And furthermore, if it says you can take a reduction step, it will tell you which reduction step you can take. Preservation says you don't even need to prove preservation for an inherently tight system. But for an extrinsically tight, preservation says if you have a term and it's well tight and you can take a reduction step, the new term is also well tight with the same type. So just by repeating those two, you can reduce the term resource score. Now there's one little twist that you need to be aware of, but this is something that people do understand widely, which is just, well, wait a minute, the reduction may not terminate. Everything in ADD is guaranteed to terminate. How do we deal with that? It's very easy. Just give a count. And count down by one each time you do this. And if you reach zero, stop and say, I'm sorry, you didn't give me a big enough number that I can actually reach the answer. We also do this for very different reasons with cryptocurrencies, and it's called gas. So the name of this parameter is called gas. And we just do a count, right? So if you give it a term, if your gas is zero, you stop. And if it's not zero, you apply progress. Either you're done, you've got a value, or you can take a step, in which case we use preservation to show that thing is also well tied, and then we can reverse. So it's very easy. And that's me. I'm done. Various people said on Twitter that they liked the book, which is great. The book is here. Please look at it and send me your comments. And more importantly, the book is also here. You can download it, you can execute it, and most importantly, when you find a typo, you can send me a pull request. So you can correct my typos or other infelicities for me. And many, many people have done this already, which is great. All right, you can see I'm at time. Thank you very much.
Okay. Why you didn't consider it horologically?
There's limited time available. I thought it was more important to show the variance of lambda calculus. That's one reason. The other reason is that the proofs in horologic are more... There is something in Pierce's book which, given an annotated term, all the invariants, turns it into verification conditions. And then you use a tactic to check the verification conditions. That would be hard in ADDICTS. I don't have tactics. So that one thing would be difficult to do.
Another question is, the students, do you know about the experience of the students? Do they like more ADDICTS or because we have this? Yeah, I think you did Turing probes, so.
This is the first time I've taught the course.
Yeah.
Some of the students, I think, well, they've been exposed to Isabel. I'm not sure that any of the students have been exposed to talk. But certainly what's happened is every time previously I've taught the course, most of my time in tutorials is spent helping people figure out what to do with tactics. the students, I would say they don't seem any less lost, but at least when they're lost, they're looking at the right sort of thing. The stuff that compares directly to knowing how proofs work, rather than stuff that's slightly irrelevant about packets. And the students just this morning took their first mock exam, so I will get some data about how well they've done in terms of understanding the course, but I'm hoping they will do just as well. I expect the students, all the ones that have been doing the course throughout, to do perfectly on the final exam. So we'll see if that happens. Yeah?
So I teach students, I say particularly they spend time, sometimes I have to spend time attending stuff they want to do, and I know this and I put my hand before I come on. And often enough, when you're trying to model something, you have to take the choice that your group of library likes. If you don't, this stuff. Like, for instance, if you have to say the card number of the set is greater than zero, it's better to say the domain is not in two, for instance, because it's enough. So you don't make sets is easier than you can find analysis, for example, and you can find an equivalent representation. How about in your case, do you get to make this kind of decision that's based on how the underlying tool writes it, or do you, can you express it as clearly as you wish?
It's gotten to the point that my notion of what's clear that aligns exactly with what Adler wants. But I don't see Adler's getting in my way in that sense. Right, the example of what you're saying about aligning is to say, well, it's better to do it intrinsically if your proofs become unsure. Okay, but is that an artifact of Adler, or is that just an artifact of the way logic works? I'm not sure. Certainly sometimes Adler, right, is still fighting with the system, trying to get it to do something. But usually that's just like, I misspelled something, but it takes me 10 minutes to notice I misspelled something. So I would say a little bit less, but I don't feel in a position to say, oh yes, you can always do exactly what you want. But there's certainly times like that. I gave one example where I said, oh yeah, I just did the proof my induction over the types. Whereas with Kopp, they had to do the induction over the terms. So I cannot think of any place where Adler really frustrated me.
Because yes, when you have to explain the tactics and also, oh, and actually that how the field people likes it makes it a very difficult exercise.
Oh, I can think of one place where they could do things differently. I was proving reduction is deterministic. You have to look at all pairs of reductions that you might have. And a pair of potato xi and a beta will look at the order xi beta and then the order beta xi. You just cut and paste one proof to the other proof. What I'd like to do is just say, for the second proof, go back and use the first proof by swapping the arguments. If I can't swap the arguments, that's not structurally smaller. So there are ways of doing it, but it gets more complicated. That's the only place I saw it.
Only one more question, okay?
It's a good one.
Agda is fairly well developed. Agda, I think, is the system that's most committed to just using type theory and nothing else. And I'm partial to Haskell, and Agda is a direct descendant of Haskell. It makes many of the same syntactic decisions. And we teach our first year students Haskell. So Agda is a very natural example for that reason. So those are the main reasons. But what do you think would be an alternative that I might look at? Oh, right, no, Idris is not designed for doing proofs, and Agda is, so Agda is definitely a better choice for that reason. So between Agda and Idris, I do know the answer. The answer is Agda if you're interested in proofs. If you just want programming, Idris might be better.
We're now going into the last talk. Alexandre is a lecturer at the Universidade Federal de Pernambuco. I'm going to give us the last talk of the morning, after which we're going for lunch.
afternoon, Dee. This is joint work with Madiel Conserva Filho, Rafael Marinho e Jim Woodcock. And it's about how to perform probabilistic analysis with this graphical language named RoboChart. Well, RoboChart was introduced last year as an invited speaker in the SPMF by Professor Anna Cavalcanti from the University of York. She has a project named RoboCalc, RoboCalc project, where she developed the RoboChart language to deal with robotic systems and autonomous systems. The main worry in this kind of systems is about safety properties, but other properties are of interest as well. So this language RoboChart is a graphical DSL similar to Simulink, for those who know Simulink, or UML as well. It has a form of semantics expressed in CSP. It was given in York, so we just inherit this semantics here. And this language has also a probabilistic operator, but no formal semantics about this probabilistic operator was given in terms of a probabilistic model. It was given in terms of CSP. So this language, although it has the probabilistic property, we can do not perform any analysis with it, right? This language is, this is just part of it. This is just a state machine in a tool support named RoboTool. So we indeed have a tool on top of Eclipse. It's a Java tool where the specifier can model the behavior of a robot and perform a set of properties. But in general, these properties are functional because they are given, expressed in CSP, right? So this work was about how to perform the probabilistic analysis in a similar way as Professor Meseghem showed us with those graphs about the performance of the system, availability, and so on and so forth, right? So this is the goal of this talk. This is the probabilistic operator. This is a system of a car that it's trying to find some obstacles. And in this case, it has 50% to turn left, 50% to turn right, and so on and so forth. A very simple example, and just to illustrate the language. Well. The probabilistic operator is basically this circle with the P letter. There is a probabilistic junctor, its name, with existing transitions annotated with probabilities. E1 and P2 are probabilities, and A1 and A2 are actions in the terminology of CSP events, if you prefer, right? And in the translation given in York, this operator was translated into CSP as a non-determinist choice. So you completely lose the probabilistic aspect in this translation, okay? So you can perform any probabilistic analysis with this. So we cannot perform the analysis as well as we cannot ensure this important property of probabilistic systems, that the sum of the existing transitions must be 100% in discrete systems. Okay. Right. So, just to you understand a little bit better why this work is relevant or difficult, I bring here a comparison between these two languages, CSP, the left column, and all. You can put all probabilistic language representatives in that the right column, right? So in CSP, you have a functional language with rich data types. Except for floating point numbers, you have integers, booleans, sets, tuples, enumerated types, and so on and so forth, in such a way that it's so rich. Once upon a time, I implemented Z in terms of CSP, just to illustrate the idea of the expressiveness of CSP, right? But probabilistic languages are, at least for me, are very poor, right? Because they are, when talking to Jim, we concluded that in general probabilistic languages are like assembly languages, and these are high-level languages compared to programming languages, okay? So when you have to express a problem in CSP, it's more natural than in probabilistic languages. At least for me, because of my formation maybe, but in general that's the case. Here we have the functional aspect, and sometimes the imperative one, if you consider CSP sharp and the PAT refinement and model checker. Whereas in the probabilistic side, we have in general imperative choice, like the Dijkstra language, or control structures in the probabilistic GCD language. Okay, and CSP, as yesterday we have a good presentation about CSP, several talks, and CSP has a lot of powerful process operators. Whereas in the probabilistic language we have a few of them, and the semantics is completely different from CSP and probabilistic language.
What about languages like PEPA?
PEPA? PEPA? Yeah,
PEPA. Different probabilistic high calculus.
Yeah, PEPA, I partly never worked with it, but I worked with Prism, Storm, and other language as well, and PEPA is translated into Prism. If I don't, I'm almost sure about that.
Yeah, because we're in the same now.
Right, but I think that PEPA is not so expressive in the size of data types. All these languages are very, very expressive in terms of transitions, probabilistic transitions, because it's their focus. But not in the data types. Data types are very poor. That's the point. Why is that the point? Because we have to translate RoboSharp. RoboSharp is a language that uses high-level data types, enumerations and vectors and matrices, etc. And this is very difficult to translate directly in PEPA, Prism, Storm, etc. Right? But they already have been translated into CSP because the effort of the ERP, right? So one way we can achieve a probabilistic analysis is this way. We inherit the CSP semantics and try to find a way of mapping CSP to the probabilistic language as we intend to perform the analysis. The other case, naturally, is to perform the direct mapping from RoboSharp directly to the probabilistic language, right? The point here is that if I take this alternative, I can have more confidence that the semantics given by York was preserved. If I take this mapping, the direct mapping, I cannot ensure quite directly that this semantics was preserved, right? So what we indeed are doing, the both alternatives. We are working these directions and in this direction as well. And after Particularly, this part is completely finished. We intend to prove the equivalence of both of the natives in UTP. Right? So the main advantage here is to present the York semantics and get the rich data types free of charge. Whereas in this case, we can map the state machine very easily, but the data types are very difficult to map, right? Just to give an idea, we have performed some experiments on a tabular frame, and just that was very difficult to characterize in prison because of obstacles and so on and so forth, right? So, as I told you, we have to prove this way or the other are correct in the sense of soundness and completeness theorems, or as well as an equivalence between both translations. But as a summative test, we can also, and it's indeed what we have done here, we can perform, like Professor Meseguer showed here, you can perform quantitative analysis and show the shape of the curve as well as the numerical populations that are the same answer, right, for some representative systems. So the way we have performed this work was based on a somehow older work, the watchdog transformation for CSP. This work was very important for the FDR model checker because it took a refinement like this, where I is an implementation and S is a specification. I is supposed to preserve the properties stated in this specification, right? And this is rewritten as this process expression involving a parallelism and a hiding. And here it's curious because it's the negation of the refinement. That's the case of this special process named watchdog. It observes the behavior of S in relation to I. If S can perform the same event as I, this process behaves like I. So they synchronize without problem. But if S does not conforms with I, this process performs a fail event and stops. And if this fail event, that is the single event that can be allowed in this hiding, it appears here and this refinement holds what's not the case, right? I don't know if you understood because it's the negation of this, but that's the idea, right? And so this was proven, and this was very important for FDR because this kind of refinement is faster, very faster than this one, because of this hiding. You hide all events except the fail one, right? For some machinery reason, FDR performs very well in this kind of refinement. Okay. In a later work, this is indeed a technical report. Particularly Michael Goldsmith, responsible for FDR in that time, showed that by introducing a somewhat probabilistic operator in CSP, this is indeed a kind of annotation in events in the LTS of the transition machine, he can calculate probabilistic analysis by using CSP directly. Because we have CSP functional analysis, we have probabilistic CSP, right? But probabilistic CSP does not have N2 of support, N support 2. And what he did was to extend CSP with this operator, the pure CSP with this operator, and producing a specific algorithm to perform the probabilistic analysis, but the probabilistic analysis is not done by FDR itself. What he does, he just translates the LTS based on this watchdog transformation to a Prism source code. So it translates CSP to Prism. And this is very important, at least for those that use CSP, because you can write any CSP process with probabilities and make analysis in CSP. This is cool because using Prism directly is much more difficult than using CSP, at least I think usually, right? And with these two questions that we perform in Prism, these two questions are used to relate to this refinement in phrases. This is refinement can be given in the failures model as well, but in this work we just have performed the analysis in the traces model, right? So these probabilities indeed give you something like what's the chance of these refines, okay, or this refinement holds. So at this point, we just illustrate to you. If you have a game of a die, right, and you annotate 50% in each transition here, this is an example taken directly from the Prism website, from the Oxford University. It can be modeled in PCSP, like this, quite similar to the picture, as well as in the Prism language. For this example, this particular example, because the data types are very simple, there is not much difference, okay? But even in this case, the CSP process is cleaner or shorter than the Prism code. I don't know if you agree with me, right? This Prism code uses two variables because Prism is a state-based language. It's like an assembly language, but this describes a straight transition machine with probabilities, right? This indeed is translated by probabilistic language into a Markov chain and so on and so forth, like Professor Mezeguer told us as well, right? So we took this CSP notation and the previous Prism code. We used the watchdog transformation that I showed you in the previous slide. We get this ugly Prism code, right? This is a parallel composition between the watchdog process and your process. This is the corresponding translation to that theorem proved in the paper of the watchdog transformation, right? In brief, this parallelism becomes a single machine where one composed to the other, whereas at least for reading it's quite different from that one, that is shorter. But what is important is that the semantics is the same, right? When you perform the Prism compilation in both source codes, the semantics is the same. That's the most important part of this comparison, right? So what we have done, we given another definition for the probabilistic operator or RoboShot. Instead of non-determinism, we converted this into this annotation, where this is just to create integer numbers, just 10 times, 100 times, etc. to create integer numbers, but corresponding to these probabilities following this calculation here. this calculation here, right? You take the left side and divide by the sum, and take you on the right side and divide by the sum. So by doing this, we get two things. We get the property. We can ensure directly in RoboChat, we can ensure that this is true. Okay. Indeed, we could perform this particular property already in the tool directly without this alternative. But in this case, this is ensured directly by translating Prism and compiling the tool. The Prism tool, if this is not ensured, it reports an error message to the system. Okay. And as we was our main goal, the probabilistic analysis can be done at this time. Okay. So the system works like this. You have the RoboChat with the extended semantics based at that operator. This is quite cool because we in a meeting with Jim said that what it was impressed that we can take CSP and leave to the Prism by just one operator, single operator, and you can put probabilistic analysis in the computer. So that's what we have done. And with the watchdog transformation that is implemented directly in the FDR tool, we get the Prism code free to use in the analysis. The main question here was that we considered this example showing that the semantics is the same, but we have no idea if the semantics given by RoboChat was presented, because the CSP produced by RoboChat was quite big. The analysis itself done in FDR takes a lot of time. So we have no idea if this is the case. We had to make experimentations, and so one of the cases we used was this one, where we already know the shape of the curve, like Professor Meisinger showed here yesterday. And by stating this property, the S in that refinement in the last slide that I showed you, we take this refinement in the FDR tool. This refinement indeed is a probabilistic refinement. It's not a trace refinement directly, because the foraging, this is the CSP from this code that is probabilistic. Okay? Are you following? Okay. So this is not just a trace refinement. This is a probabilistic transformation that creates a prism that by analysis produces this graph.
What if it was held by emergency? How the probabilities?
Failure divergence indeed is not that weak. Just trace or failure. The technicalities are in the paper. We just considered for this point the trace model, because we performed just reachability analysis and was enough to this part of the project. But we with this example we could show two things. The first one was that this curve calculates exactly the same values as expected by another example. That's very different from RoboChat. It's a Prism example. And we take the same example with a direct translation from RoboChat to Prism. As this example is very simple because of the data structures, the calculations were the same in both ways, right? To finish this talk, the conclusions are that we have probabilistic analysis in RoboChat, but the most important point is that we preserved all the original CSP semantics given in York. And with this, we have a capability of analyzing rich data structures. That's not the case in many probabilistic languages. And no prism background is needed because we perform all the analysis in the RoboSharp core in CSP level, right? For future work, we intend to, this translation done theoretically is almost, I would say, 9% done without rich data structures. But this Epson model transformation is being created in a tool, and as well as this expressively UTP, Unified Theories of Programming, from Horan Hitchfang. The same will be done with this watchdog transformation that I showed to you, because at this point, this transformation was just inherited from the literature, right? But we need it in terms of the UTP as well, using the Isabel UTP framework created in New York. Explore and compare both techniques as well as prove their equivalence, as I said to you previously. And finally, model and analyze more case studies, particularly in the Prism Model Checker, not using RoboCharm, but using CSP. I would like to show to the community, particularly for the probabilist community, that is much more interesting to use a language like CSP than a language like Prism or Storm or Kepa, etc. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, RoboSharp is indeed a language that emerged in the RoboCalc project from Professor Ana Cavalcante, as I said. We are working in this partnership, Professor Augusto Sampaio, me, and other professors with the group of Ana. And the main goal is to have a language to model and express properties of robotic and autonomous systems that is richer or easier for the engineer than Simulink and other language offered in the market, right? It's not CSP, it's much more easier to express properties than it's like UML or something like this, right? So we expect the engineers use RoboChart more easily than CSP directly. The idea, as I said in the invited talk here, the idea is always hiding completely the use of formal methods as much as we can, right? Because this is the use of the problem.
What is the Prism community? They think that is this a nice way of using their language, or what's their
opinion? Right, that's the point I'm trying to bring the next step, right? Because I think they do not like but I am a CSP user for how much time? Maybe 20 years or I don't know. But for Prism, I'm a 3 years or maybe 5 years user. And I think that I can compare both languages. And I do prefer CSP, right? But the point is, when you use a CSP language to make a model of a system, this is very different than when you use Prism or Paper or other things, right? Because with CSP you are worried about behaviors and things like this, etc. Whereas when you use Prism, you are focusing on the quantitative part, just that. So you abstract a lot of things. This is curious because the CSP model created by RoboSharp is very heavy for FDR. But the principle generated is very light to analyze. Because of that, because of the hiding, you throw away a lot of events, right?
So you look for the right thing for the right task.
Yeah. But the point is, when you use prism directly, you have to worry about these things. If you can use CSP, that for me, it's much more instructive and interesting to model things. You can model all aspects, and with this transformation, you can discharge the path that's not interesting.